New tonight, former President Trump attacking the former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie. Well, the reason is that Christie said Republicans need to look ahead. They need to move past the 2020 election. That's it. Stop talking about 2020. That's what he said. Well, Trump is livid, and he has come out and claimed that Christie was, quote, absolutely massacred for these statements. Well, Christie's comments at the time and the location, a GOP event, received only a little applause. But there are others in the party who agree with him. Jeff Zeleny is out front.
A Republican resurgence is in the air, exactly 1 year before the 2022 midterm elections.
We can no longer talk about the past and the past elections. No matter where you stand on that issue, no matter where you stand, it is over.
Former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie offering a blunt roadmap for the party's future.
Every minute that we spend talking about 2020, while we're wasting time doing that, Joe Biden, Kamala Harris, Nancy Pelosi, and Chuck Schumer are laying ruin to this country. We better focus on that and take our eyes off the rearview mirror and start looking through the windshield again.
He's talking, of course, about former President Donald Trump.
I may even decide to beat them for a third time, okay?
The proverbial elephant in every Republican room, whose conspiracy theories, grievances, and score settling are a driving force in a party still firmly in his command. A year after losing the White House and control of Congress, Republicans are at a critical crossroads as they capitalize on Democratic divisions in hopes of reclaiming their majority.
Is President Trump part of that discussion? Of course he is. And those voices that want to silence him, I think, are ridiculous.
Fresh signs of optimism are coursing through the GOP, following a big win in the Virginia governor's race and a stunning finish in New Jersey. Yet those signs of strength have shined a brighter light in balancing the risks and rewards of embracing the former president. Today in Kentucky, Senate Republican leader Mitch McConnell instructed his party to spend more time talking about President Biden.
The key to 22 is to have a discussion with the American people about how they feel about the new administration and the Democratic Congress and what they're doing. So I think the election will be about the future, not about the past.
Trump's role in midterm election races and whether he runs for president again is a central question hanging over the party. At a weekend GOP gathering in Las Vegas, that question was on the back burner as former Vice President Mike Pence and a parade of Republicans made appearances.
Just 12 months away from a great Republican comeback, and we're going to win back this country in 2024.
That field of potential 2024 candidates is already taking shape, with more than a dozen ambitious Republicans in the earliest stages of exploring a run, some of whom said they would step aside if Trump steps up again. Not Christie, who told CNN's Maeve Reston that doing so would be a sign of weakness.
Anybody who says that they'll step aside for anybody else, I'd say to you, doesn't belong being president. You don't believe in yourself enough to stand up to anyone, then you can't possibly stand up for everyone.
To rebuild, Republicans know they must win over at least some of the suburban voters who left the party under Trump. That was one of the brightest spots for the GOP in last week's elections. Longtime Republican Ari Fleischer, a former White House press secretary, said any questions about Trump would be answered after the midterm elections.
This suburban reversal is significant, with or without Donald Trump on the ballot. The trick for Republicans going forward, in my opinion, is to keep revving up the rural areas and the lower income, non-college educated areas, and just be reasonable in the suburbs. Don't scare people, and the suburbs will come home.
Now, even as Christie and other Republicans urge the party to look forward, not backward, Aaron, that debate is not happening in all quarters of the party.
No.
Tonight, right now, the former president is headlining a House Republican fundraising dinner. Kevin McCarthy, of course, has chosen to embrace the former president. 1 year from tonight, the votes are counted in those midterm election races.
Well, one year from tonight and how fast it will go. Jeff, thank you. So I want to go now to Republican Congressman Tom Reed of New York, because he's a member of the Bipartisan Problem Solvers Caucus. So Congressman Reed, you know, I think it's amazing that there's a debate over whether one should move past an election that happened in the past as opposed to focusing on the future. But nonetheless, that is core right now. It's a fight within your party for the soul of your party. How do you see it? Not how do you want to see it, not how do you want it to be. How do you see it? Is Trump still the future of the Republican Party or not?
Well, you know, obviously, President Trump has a huge influence over the Republican Party. And when it comes to policies and things he's advocated for that kind of broke out Republican orthodoxy, I will tell you, he was on the right message and he was bringing the right policies. And so I think we're going to see President Trump continue to influence the Republican Party. But I do agree with the sentiment that I just heard from your prior section. We need to be reasonable. We have to act normal. And what we have to do is lead and look to the future, because that's what the American people want us to do. They don't want us to be focusing on the past. They want us to be focusing on their future.
So what do you do then? You know, how do you know Christie is saying, Trump is saying Christie was, quote, absolutely massacred. And as we said, the applause wasn't strong, but I mean, massacred would be way too strong of a word. He's still putting out press releases saying the insurrection was actually election day. I mean, he's not letting up at all on looking back, right? I mean, is your party going to be able to win if he won't stop doing that?
Oh, I believe absolutely, because I also watch what's happening on the Democratic Party side of the ledger, and you see extremism of the left overtaking the Democratic Party. So there's going to be a contrast opportunity going forward. And I will tell you, the American people are smarter than what the inside D.C. Beltway people give them credit for. Mm. They know what they're looking for. And I'm very optimistic that the Republican Party that I believe in and the vision that I'm trying to advocate for, that will win the day come 2022 and beyond.
All right. So the Republican Party that you believe in is a party that can work with the other side. And there you're not alone, but you're in a small group. But I mean, look, 19 Republicans in the Senate, right, voted for that $1.2 trillion infrastructure package. You voted for it on Friday night. Now, let's just go through the math here. 6 Democrats opposed the bill when it came to a vote. So if all the Republicans had voted against it, it was going to fail. It was going to sink. Biden would not have gotten a crucial victory. And it would have been because his own party denied it to him. However, 13 Republicans, including you, voted for it. How come? Why did you choose to support that bill?
Because if I wanted to play partisan politics 24/7, then, of course, we would have tanked that bill, sent it back to the Senate, and then you would have taken a victory that is for the American people. This is $1.2 trillion in America's infrastructure. Mm-hmm. I've been working on this for 10 years. This was a good compromise bill, and I will tell you, if you just want to vote no and not get anything accomplished, you can do that in Washington. But I tell you, I think the American people are getting sick and tired of that.
Okay, so here's the thing. You can do that, and some of your colleagues do. I'm not saying all of them in every case, but 200 House Republicans obviously voted against this in an overwhelming majority. And some of them are really angry about what happened here, right? They're angry at people like you. Matt Gaetz, I can't believe Republicans just gave Democrats their socialism bill. Madison Cawthorn, there's a lot of Democrats who call themselves Republicans in the U.S. House. Marjorie Taylor Greene calling you and the other 12 who voted for this, quote, the 13 traitor Republicans who, quote, voted to help Biden screw America. These are your colleagues. I mean that's just, obviously a completely inappropriate way to conduct yourself with a tweet like that. But what do you say to them?
I will say, look, I'm the youngest of 12 children. I got 8 older sisters, 3 older brothers, and I've been called many a things in my life. And I'm comfortable in my vote. I'm confident in my vote. I know what was in that bill, and I know that was good for America. And I respect their difference of opinion. I respect their ability to be a member of Congress and do what they want with their position. But it doesn't mean that I'm just going to follow the crowd. I'm going to stand up for what I believe in. And I believe that was the right vote. And to be perfectly honest with you, Aaron, there were many Republicans that wanted to vote for this. And I give a little blame to the Democratic side. They waited 3 months to bring this bill to the floor. Yeah. They had at least 2 to 3 times Republicans that would have voted for it earlier, but the politics changed. And that's troublesome.
That's interesting. So you think it would have been 2 to 3 times. That's a lot. That's almost,
yeah, because you had 19 Senate Republicans voting for it.
Yeah.
Just do the math and it would reflect the same in the House.
Yeah, no, you're right. 26 to 40, and that would have been a very significant. All right, well, I really appreciate your time, and thank you. I did not know you were the youngest of 12, and I now will never forget it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Aaron.